You're listening to In the Moment on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm your host, Lori Walsh. Well, what does it mean to be a philanthropist? Stephen Wilcox is president of the Wilcox Family Foundation. He spoke this morning at the garage in Rapid City as part of the Morning Philip that's brought to you by the NUMAD Group with support from the Bush Foundation. And the Wilcox Family Foundation works in this area of supporting people who are supporting people in need. And Stephen stopped by the Rapid City studios there and is joining me now. Stephen Wilcox, thanks for being here. We appreciate your time.
Oh, my pleasure.
Now, you come from a high energy business background. You know how to get a lot of things done at once. And how did that sort of business background shift to include philanthropy in the first place? Tell us how you kind of made that adjustment.
Well, it was really a kind of a personal journey in the regards that, you know, you come from a place that it's very goal-oriented, and you've got to shift to a mindset that you're working with the community. And one of the things we discussed this morning at the garage is you can't come in and tell the community, here's what you should be doing. You know, I've got an idea and stand aside. I'm going to do it for you. You've got to listen to the community because the community knows really what they need. And you have to be there to be an ally, not their boss.
Do you find pushback against that from people who say, I don't think the community does know what they need? I think, you know, people who have a lot of experience, you know, strategic planning and making decisions and executing things might be tempted to say, we know better. Like, do you have people who push back against that idea?
You make a great point. I would say that the pushback comes from, you know, sometimes in the delivery of the execution. Mm-hmm. So the community will look to you and say, we haven't seen this problem before. What might you offer? What ideas might you offer? But it's still the community that needs then to come to you and say, of the ideas we've considered, we'd like to do this one. Will you help us get it done mm-hmm. with your perhaps with your resources, perhaps with your connections. But it's still got to be something that they buy into. Again, my experience has told me that forcing a solution on the community might end up with a set of housing solutions, but no one will be happy about it. Versus having the community decide what housing solutions they would accept, and you helping them develop them.
You've done some partnership work with Red Cloud Indian School. By way of example, can you tell us a little bit about some of those initiatives?
Well, I've been at Red Cloud as a volunteer on committees and on the board for, oh gosh, more than 20 years. The one that I would point to was a while ago when we were approached by the school at the time. Now, this is going back a bit. At the time, the school didn't have any specific resources aimed at college counseling. So despite the fact that they were really focused on getting the students into college and they were proud of their enrollment rates into college, they didn't have anyone really focused with helping the students. And we were approached to try to provide the resources to get that done, provide the financial resources. My wife and I, through the foundation, immediately said yes. And what was curious is they turned around and said, well, why did you say yes? And we were we were a little bit taken aback and said, well, because you asked. We had already anticipated that since they were coming to us, we were anticipating an ask for something. And what they were what they were considering seemed totally reasonable, totally within the mission of the school, and well thought out. So we were, again, just trying to be a good ally.
How do you measure success? Because in some ways, you want to be able to look at the number of kids who went to college there. I can measure it. I can say this worked. But you're also building relationships and dealing with historic trauma and trying to come into a space that is multi-layered. How do you measure success in a case like that?
Well, it's a great, great question, because I think, again, if you look back at a business mindset, you'd say 75, 85, 95% we need to be successful with the students, when in fact, with a cohort, as we'd be talking about in any trauma situation, not just, and I'm not just speaking about Red Cloud, but any marginalized community, you could think of one that's, let's say, inner city that's living with a lot of violence, success might be 35%. So you really have to be able to think that failure could be part of the equation here, and experimenting could be part of the equation, that new ideas, new approaches, again, that the community supports could be part of the equation. So you make a great point. You can't bring your business mindset that unless we're 100% successful or 90% successful, you're not going to get any funding. You have to be working with the community and be, you know, very much aware of the kind of trauma in the community and be making progress towards realistic goals and ever-increasing, you know, hurdles that you've got to come up with new solutions to so you can increase the success rates.
My research shows that you have an intersection between your work and your personal faith. Do I have that correct, or have I been misled?
You have that correct.
Tell me about that and how this work that you do now has deepened your faith or challenged your faith.
I think I originally established sort of a generous spirit from my mother. Mm. Who always felt there was another place at the table. She was a wonderful, I'd consider her a saint. and I think that for me sort of generated a lifetime of giving. Ultimately, it turned into a tithe, if you're aware of that term,
sure.
Where you'd put aside 10%, and not the last 10%, but the first 10%. So Peggy and I, my wife and I, started a tradition of ending the year with a stack of requests for money and a checkbook and a bottle of wine. And we would give until we'd given 10%. It then turned into the foundation, but it was all based on, I think, my mother's generous Christian spirit, that there was always another room, always another place at the table, regardless of how much was available. There was always one more mouth we could feed.
Wow, what a beautiful tradition to think of at the new year. Stephen Wilcox with the Wilcox Family Foundation, thanks for coming to the Morning Philip today, and thanks to the folks from the NewMed Group for bringing you by to talk to the rest of South Dakota, many of whom can't reach you, so we bring your voice all across the state. We appreciate your time. Thank you.
Well, thanks for having me. I appreciate it.